but in NoSQL it can support more than 1 TB data also. Here we can easily handle the large volume of data, because nowadays with the internet era, the day by day the internet users are getting increased, because everyone is using the YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, etc. So in olden days, only few people are generating the data. Example, the olden paradigm, newspaper is generated by only the few people, but all are utilizing it. But the new paradigm say, everyone is generating data and everyone is using the data. Say an example, Facebook, everyone is generating the command, WhatsApp, Telegram, everyone is generating the content, and also everyone is using it, utilize it. So when you, in olden days, so one to many utilization, but nowadays, many to many. The sources are many and the utilization is also many. So it's a many to many. So now we are in the position to handle the large volume of data. So we had obviously had to go for the NoSQL. Then what is NoSQL? It's not only the SQL. It can ability to deal with the rich variety of data, like structured data, semi-structured data, and unstructured data, etc. But in RDBMS, where we can handle only the structured data, but we can handle any kind of data. The NoSQL, the initially it's a relational database, that is where we can store the data in the form of table. But in and also the here we use the OLAP, some analytical online. The expansion of OLAP is online analytical processing. There are two different things are there. OLAP, okay, OLAP in the sense where we can perform some analytical operation like aggregate operation, minimum value, maximum, like that, mainly for aggregated value. Okay, what is the maximum salary and minimum salary? What is the total salary? Like that, this all can be done with the help of this RDBMS. But not only the SQL, where here actually we store the data in different format. Here only the two operations. Here we can store the data in key value format or column family or graph or document, etc. Okay, because we are having many software. Based on the requirement, we can choose the software. So first one is the different types of NoSQL. Key value. I hope everyone has downloaded the software, MongoDB software. Just today morning, the Thirumal sir said the procedure to download the MongoDB software. Even if anyone is, somebody is not downloaded, please you can download the software. I'll tell the procedure, how to download the MongoDB software. Okay, I hope the screen is visible to you. You can go and go for this link. Okay. You can go to this link and you can, one second, I will copy the link. You can or you can type https://mongodb.com, then try download community. MongoDB.com, try download community, then you'll get this screen. In this screen, the available download, you can choose the latest version, okay, not the 4.2.8. You can choose the latest version and the Windows and MSI file. That is the expansion of MSI, Microsoft installer. I will change it to the Windows installer. Okay. Microsoft installer, now it's changed to the Windows installer. Again, one second. Yes, you can. Yes, the latest version is 4.43. Okay, I will share it. You can click this website web link. Okay, you can click this web link and you can download the MongoDB software. If already you downloaded, it's no problem. I think the latest version is 4.43. If you want to open it, then you'll get the screen. That screen you can type, sorry, you can select 4.43. This is the latest version. The platform you can choose, it's the Windows, and the package is MSI, that is Microsoft Installer. Just you click download, it takes some time. That's what that morning I said at the procedure to download. I think already Thirumurthy are given the instructions to download this file. Okay, anyway, let me continue the session. If you have any doubt, you can send the message through our chat box. There are different types of NoSQL, like key value, column family, graph, document, etc. Anyway, the first one, in key value, here you can store everything in the form of key value. Okay, say an example, roll number, then corresponding value. Here, roll number is considered as a key, and corresponding value is considered as a value. That is, a relationship between key and corresponding value. The name is a key. The Raj is a value. That's what key value relationship. That's the next one, document. The example for a key value, even Dynamo database, Redis, React, that all are stored the data in the form of key value format. But in document oriented, it maintains the data in collection of documents. Say an example, MongoDB, Apache KafkaDB, Kafkbase, Market Logic. These are the database like MongoDB. This MongoDB, here we can store the data in the form of document. Okay, MongoDB, we can store the data in the form of document. This is a sample JSON document, like roll number, name, and year of joining, etc. Similarly, column. Suppose if you are going to calculate the aggregated value, like maximum salary, minimum salary, where we can go for the column wise. So in that situation, better we can go for NoSQL instead of the SQL, like RDBMS. So here, the Cassandra, HBase, these are the examples where we can arrange the data in the column wise. Last one, graph database. This is also called a network database. There are different graph databases, are Neo4j, Hypergraph, etc. These are the graph database. I think the Facebook, they are using the graph database. That's what we are getting the suggestion, like a friend of friend. You can get the suggestion from the your friend of friend. There are different types of NoSQL are there. The main advantages of this NoSQL is it's very cheap and easy to implement and easy to distribute. Distribute in the sense we can store data in multiple locations and can easily scale up and scale down. In the sense, if the number of users gets increased, then automatically the server gets increased. If the number of users get decreased, it automatically get reduced. Okay, this allows you have some flexibility. Okay, it can allow the n number of maximum participants and data consistency requirement. Data consistency means if you are sending the amount from source to destination. Say an example, both the sides, the database should be consistent, that is stable. Then only we can call it a database. Always our database should be stable. If you are transferring the amount from your account to your account also should be stable and your friend's account is also should be stable. We can ensure the consistency using the different techniques. Then we have some predefined schema and we can replicate and duplicate it and we can partition the data to multiple locations. These are the main advantages of this NoSQL. Some popular NoSQL vendors, the Amazon, their product is DynamoDB. This product most widely used by LinkedIn and Mozilla. Similarly, the Facebook product is Cassandra. This product is widely used by Netflix, Twitter, eBay, and Google. They are using the Bigtable, but the product is used by Adobe Photoshop. These are some popular NoSQL vendors. Okay, before starting the NoSQL, first we will the MongoDB. There are so many NoSQL DBs are there. Here we are going to focus on MongoDB because it's most widely used the database. Okay, that's what I chose this. So what is MongoDB? It's a crash platform. Crash platform in the sense we can work the MongoDB in Windows machine, Apple Mac, then even Linux, Unix, etc. You can choose any platform. And it's a open source. It is a non-relational. Non-relational means here we no need to organize the data in the form of table. And it's a distributed. We can store the data to multiple locations. It's a NoSQL. That is no. It's not only the structured query language. And also already said the MongoDB is a document-oriented data store. Here MongoDB, we can store the data in the form of document. Then CAMPS used in RDBMS and MongoDB. RDBMS and MongoDB. Both are can call it a database. The collection of table is considered as a database in RDBMS. Here you can use the collection instead of table. In RDBMS, we can call it a table, but in MongoDB, you can call it a collection. Similarly, the row, in RDBMS, row is called as a record, but in MongoDB, the row is called as a document. In RDBMS, we can call it a column, but here we can call it a fields are key value pairs. Similarly, the index, joins, and primary key, etc. In RDBMS, simply we can use the primary key. Here we have to use one prefix underscore in order to identify the primary key. Primary key in the sense that is unique value. Later we will discuss in detail about that. Okay. Then the terms used in RDBMS and MongoDB. MySQL, we can server and client. In MySQL, we can use MySQL daemon, that is server. MySQL means client. Similarly, the Oracle is a server. SQL plus is a client. In MongoDB, MongoD is a server, Mongo is client. Okay. MongoD means server, Mongo means client. That's the difference between server and client. Okay, before starting this query, first we'll install the MongoDB software. I hope everyone is downloaded this software. If you find any difficulties to download this software, please you can send a message through the chat box. Okay, I think 10 to 15 minutes you try to finish this, because next day you have to work the queries. MongoDB installation and configuration setup guide. Okay, the MongoDB, you know that already, the same story. Open source, it's a non-relational, the cross platform, it's a document-oriented database. That is scale in, scale out architecture. We have the flexible schema. The sense a schema means it's going to describe the structure of the database. Okay, the consistent, etc. Already we have discussed. This MongoDB supports both the 32-bit as well as the 64-bit OS. You no need to bother about it. Okay, it can support both the 32-bit as well as the 64-bit operating system, Windows operating system. It's highly efficient and it's highly availability and horizontal expansion, etc. These are some advantages of this MongoDB. Then I hope you can download the latest version of MongoDB. I think I already said the latest version is somewhat different. It's not 4.28. Okay, you can download this MongoDB software from this location. Once you download it, I hope everyone is downloaded this software. Then if you see the downloaded place, you can get this file. Okay, once you get this file, you can install this file. In order to install this file, just you right click this, okay, install the MongoDB software MSI file, okay, which you have downloaded already. Before installing the software, you make sure that we have the admin privileges. You should be in admin login. Okay, then only you are easily can install the software, because we are having some privacy issues. So you can ensure that you are in the admin login, and this software can be installed in both the 32-bit as well as the 64-bit version of MongoDB for Windows. In order to install it, just you click the install option. Just you right click it. The thing is, you should be in admin login, and you should click the right button. Then you'll get this install option. Just you select it. Okay, already I downloaded, already I have installed in my machine. Okay, if you want, I will show it to you. Download. Okay, you will get the file like this. Then 4.4.3. Then you just click, right click it, and you click the install button. Okay. If you have any doubt, you can send a message through our chat box. Okay, thank you. Just you click, right click, and you click install. I'll go step by step. Then you will get the screen like this. Then welcome to this MongoDB and latest edition 4.4.4. Then it can support both the 32-bit as well as the 64-bit machine. Just you select the next button. I hope everyone is able to follow me. Just you click the next button. Okay, once you click the next button, then you'll get this screen. Okay, for this license agreement, just you can enable this. Just you put tick mark this for this license agreement in our terms to be approved by the end user. Okay, that is the end user license agreement. You can just please check it. I accept the terms and the terms in the license agreement. Once you enable it, just you tick it, then you can click the next button. I hope if you need, I'll use first thing you should download this file. The next thing, you have to right click and install this file. Then you'll get the screen like this. You have to click the next button. Then you have to check it. By default, it's disable mode. You have to enable it. Once you enable it, then next you can click the next button. I hope are you able to follow me? Okay, once you enable it, then you'll get this screen to install all the features like component, like complete and a custom package. Complete means it can install all the features and the components. If you choose the custom, maybe you can restrict the user to install only the particular product. Maybe you have so many features here. If you need only the selected features, you can go for the custom. But here I chose the complete because you can get all the features and components. So better my option is better, you can choose the complete option. Just you click this complete. Once you click this complete, then you'll get this next screen like this. You'll get this service configuration file screen. In this service configuration screen, you have to select the run service as network service user. By default, it's the radio button is a disabled mode. You have to click enable the install MongoDB service, and you have to select the run service as network service user. You have to take it, you have to enable it, and you have to select the run service as network service user. Once you did it, then next you can click the next button. Actually, just you remember this location, your data files and log files, everything is going to store this location. Anyway, you no need to type it. By default, automatically you'll get this path location. Okay, if you select enable it and you can choose this run service as network user, then this is for mainly for you can, in order to continue the MongoDB installation, you have to perform the service configuration. The next, for just you keep remember this location. For future reference, make a note of the data directory. Just you remember this location, because later we need this location. In actually, our file is going to store in the C equivalent and program file. Under the program files directory, you'll get the one more directory like MongoDB. In that, we it has subdirectory like server and the 4.2 and data. Just you keep remember this for the future reference. Once you keep remembering, the next you'll get you have to click the next button. Once you click the next button, then you'll get this screen like this. Already we did this all these steps. So again, you have to click this next button for the screen navigation. Then you'll get the screen like this in MongoDB campus. This MongoDB campus is easy to use, and even it requires no knowledge of MongoDB queries. You don't need to write any queries. So better you can deselect and click next. By default, it's in enable mode. Better you can deselect it, disable this option. Okay. Better you can disable this option or deselect it, and then you click next. By default, the MongoDB campus means you no need of any query language. Simply you can use drag and drop. So my suggestion is, better you can do the sum. Then only we can understand the concept behind that. So better you can deselect it, and you can click the next button. Once you deselect and click the next button, then you'll get the screen like this. Then you have the option called install. So better you can click this install to begin the installing MongoDB. Not only we are going to install this MongoDB software. Click install to begin installing MongoDB. Once you click this install button, it takes some time for the installation. We'll get the screen like this. It shows that the validation of installation is in progress. Okay, the validation of the installation is in progress. It takes some time. So once it's completed, then you can click the next button. I hope you are able to follow me. If you find any difficult, please you message through our chat box. Even if I'm a little bit fast, you can convey through our chat box. Okay. I hope if it is completed, then you'll get the next screen. Okay. To complete installation, finish click. That's all. The installation over. Next, we have the configuration step. That's all. Up to this, the installation step is over. If you want, again, I'll start from the beginning. I think it takes only 2 to 3 minutes. Sometimes maybe the installation takes some time. You have to download this file from this website, the web link. You have to choose the latest version like 4.4.4 like that. Then Windows and the MSI file, just you click the download. You have already downloaded this particular MSI file. Once you download it, just you right click it, then you have the install option. Okay. Before install, you have ensured that you are in the admin privileges. Whether you have checked it, whether you are in the admin login. Okay. Then only you can, normally all the softwares are installed through the admin login. Then next, you can click the next button. And then you have to accept it. You have to enable this terms and conditions. Just you select it and you click the next. And then you can choose the either one, but my suggestion is better you can choose the complete. Then only you can get all the features and components. Once you click this complete, then you'll get the screen like this. Just you enable it, install MongoDB as a service. Then you can select the radio button like run service as network service user. Once you did it, just you can click the next button. Then you remember this path, because later in future we are going to use this path. Just you keep remember it. Then click the next button. Then once you know it, what, then click the next button. Again, you click the next button. Then you'll get the screen like this, like MongoDB campus. By default, the MongoDB campus is in enable mode. Just you deselect it. Here you have to deselect this option. Then you have to click the next button. Once you click the next button, then next you have the install option. Right now we are going to start the installation of MongoDB. Just you click the install. It takes some time because it's in progress. Once it finishes this process, then you can click the next button. That's all. The finally you'll get the finish button. Then finally, how to click the finish button. Then MongoDB installation is over. Once you finish this MongoDB installation, next we can start with the configuration step, how you can effectively can access this installed software. The user must customize the system using the following steps. Okay, based on our requirement, you can customize it based on our preference. So you can go to, already you know this path, that's what I asked you to remember this path. You can go to your local hard disk drive, just you click the equivalent and you will get program files and MongoDB, like that you can do it. MongoDB in server 4.2, like bin, this is the location. You can copy the location like this, and just right click it and copy. In address bar, you can go and right click and copy. Then go to the location of hard disk drive and you can see the program file, maybe this location where you can see both the MongoDB server and the client. I'll show it to you. This is Mongo. Already said MongoDB means Mongo server. Mongo means client. Now we have installed both server as well as the client. So MongoDB server, Mongo is client. So successfully we have installed the server as well as the client. So Mongo for client edition, MongoDB for server edition. Sorry, normally here actually you can work with the client server interaction. So you have to install both. By default, it is automatically it's installed. Then that's all. Just you check it. That's okay, whether it's successfully installed or not. That's what I ask you to verify it. Okay, once you check it, then you can go to this My Computer. Help. In this My Computer, just you right click it. Actually, the thing is, we can access the MongoDB software from any location. Otherwise, each and every time you have to go to this path, then you have to start this MongoDB, MongoDM, and also Mongo. So this is very complicated because you keep remembering this path is somewhat complicated. So that you can set the environment variable. Once you set the environment variable, then we can access the MongoDB from anywhere. That is any location, even the C and D directory, E directory. Okay, you can directly execute the file without you going for the particular specific folder. So you have to right click this My Computer. I hope everyone is having the My Computer screen like this. Just you right click it. And you can select this properties option. Then you'll get the screen like this. Once you get, just you go to My Computer and you can right click and you'll get the properties. Then you click it. Once you click the property, then you'll get the screen like this. In this screen, you have so many options in the control panel home. Just you have to select the advanced system settings. Okay. This advanced system setting. Once you click this advanced system setting, actually this is a tells about the our operating system and our RAM capacity 64 bit, like that it can say our computer name, etc. But you have to select the advanced system settings. Once you click this advanced system settings, then you'll get the screen like this. Once you get the screen like this, then you have to choose the environment variable in order to set the system properties. That is environment variable. You have to select the environment variable. Once you click this environment variable, then you'll get this, you can get the screen like this, like system variables, then path. Okay, actually this path, just you select the path. Once you get this under the system variables, you don't select this user variables path. Okay, just you select it under the system variable, you have the path, you click this particular path. Then you can that step, first step, you ensure that whether it's in system variable. Then second one, you can choose this path. Once you choose this path, then that step, you have to click this edit button. Once you click this edit button, actually I am going to specify the path of the MongoDB. Once you included this path of the MongoDB in the system variable, then you can access this part of MongoDB from anywhere. Just you have to click the edit button. Once you click this edit button, next you can get the screen like this. Okay, in this screen, you have to first step, you have to click the new to add the location of the MongoDB directory path in edit environment variable. Okay, just you click this new button, then automatically your cursor blinks here. Just you, I told the procedure to copy this path. Just you go to that address bar and you copy that path and just you place it, just copy and paste it. You paste the MongoDB directory location. Once again, I'll show. This is the location in the address bar. If you click it, just you'll get the path like this. Just you select and you copy it. Just simply you paste this location, okay? You paste the MongoDB directory location. Once you finish it, the first part is you have to click a new button. Then second one, you have to paste the MongoDB directory location. Then third step, you have to click OK. Once you click it, then successfully our environment variable started. Once you set it, then next step, you have to create a new folder in any directory. But here I chose the C directory. You go to new directory, you go to C directory or D directory, whatever you think. Even if you are comfortable, better you can go to C directory. You go to C directory, you create your one folder in the name of data. Once you create the folder in the name of data, just double click the particular directory and create one more subdirectory under the data, just called DB. Okay. You go to any C colon or D colon, you create your one folder name called data. All should be in lowercase. Okay. All the words should be in, all the characters should be in lowercase. Once you click the data folder, that just double click it, then you create one more subdirectory under the data, just you create a DB. That's it, DB for database. Simply create DB. Okay, that's all, the thing is over. You have successfully, we have set the configured all the things. Then you can go to this, in order to check the MongoDB version, you can go click the Windows button, and or you can use the Windows R. Okay, just you click the Windows R, you type CMD, CMD for command prompt. Then you'll get the screen like this, already said. MongoD space double hyphen version. In order to check the client version, you have to use Mongo space double hyphen version. First you'll check the server version. Just you type MongoD space double hyphen and version. Actually, I have installed 4.2.8. That's why it shows the version number is there. Version 4.2.8. I hope if you install the latest version, that will show the latest version. This is for server edition. In order to know the client edition, you have to type Mongo space double hyphen in version. It will show the both server and client. Both are the same version. Okay, but the difference between server and client is server is a MongoD and client is a Mongo. That's it. Just you, once you ensure it, then next step, this is the last step. We have to start the server as well as the client. Okay. In order to start the Mongo server, the client edition, you have to go for command prompt. Just you close it. Again, I'll tell you. Just you can go to Windows, click the Windows R, then get the command prompt. In this command prompt, first thing you have to start the server. In order to start the server, you have to type MongoD. MongoD means server, Mongo means client. Just you press enter, then server is running. You no need to close the server. Don't close the server. Once the server gets running, then you'll get the cursor is blinked here. Don't close it, just simply minimize it. Because if you want to work with client, the backend, the server should be in running mode. So you don't close it, just simply you minimize it. Okay, at background, the server is running. Again, you open one more screen, like in command prompt. Now we are going to start the client edition. In order to start the client edition, just you type Mongo. Already you have executed MongoD, MongoD for server. And you have to open one more screen, just you type Mongo. If I type Mongo, then we can, if you press the enter button, then you'll get the client screen. In this client screen, you have this arrow mark like this. Here only we are going to work our program. Okay. Do you have any doubt in this? Up to this, the installation, the configuration, installation and the configuration is over. If you have any doubt, you can send a message through our chat box. Now we are going to start the query. I hope everyone is following this. This thing, one second. You are not getting the screen like this. I think they have chosen something else. The step by step, just you follow it. It's a very simple procedure. I hope everyone did it. How many of you successfully installed this? How many of you got the screen? You can send the message through our chat box. Are you able to follow this? Otherwise, if you're not getting it, no problem. Just again, go back and you can start from the beginning. Okay, you can reply through our chat box. How many of you successfully installed this? Session complete, what next? Okay, I think installation, once you finish the installation, then the configuration. If you need, again, I will explain, otherwise I will start the query. That's what I'm asking. If you need, again, I will explain, otherwise you will start the query. Okay, again, quickly I will recall this. And just you have to download and you click right click and you just click the install button. Once you get the install button, then you'll click the next. There are two things that are very important. Here you have to select it. The terms and conditions you have to select it, and the compass you have to deselect it. Here you need to select it. Just to select and click next button and click complete. Then you enable ticket and you have to select this on service as network service user. Then click next, next, that's all. Then MongoDB campus, you have to deselect it. In service terms and service condition, you have to select it. But in MongoDB campus, you have to deselect it. Once you deselect it, then click next. Then click install, then click next, then finally get the finish. That's all, the installation is over. Once the installation is over, then next you have to ensure that the software is installed in this location or not. In order to ensure purpose, you can go to this location, like the SQL and program files. In program files, the MongoDB folder. In MongoDB folder, you have server, then 4.2 and the bin. Subdirectory like SQL and program files, MongoDB server 4.2 bin. There you'll find the two different files like MongoD and Mongo. MongoD for server, Mongo for client. Then just to close it, in order to set the environment variable. If you set the environment variable, then we can access the file from any location. We no need to mention the specific path. Otherwise, in command prompt, you have to give this exact path. In order to avoid that, you can go to the My Computer and right-click it. Just click the properties. Once you click the properties button, then you'll get the screen like this, advanced system setting. Just click this advanced system setting. Then you have to click this environment variable. Once you click the environment variable, then you'll get the screen like this. Under the system variable, you choose the path. Once you choose the path, then click the edit button. Once you click the edit button, then you'll get the screen like this. Then you click the new button. Already, I hope you know the location. Just you copy and paste this location. Paste the MongoDB directory location. Once you paste it, then you click the OK button. Once you click the OK button, you go to any directory, like C directory or T directory, D directory, whatever the convenient to you, you can go it. And you create one folder, just empty folder, like data. Once you create the data folder, the empty data folder, just double click it and create one more subfolder like DB under the data. Okay, the data folder, just want to create the data folder, just double click it and you will go. And inside of the data directory, you create one more directory, okay, or DB. That's all, just simply close it. And in order to know you no need to check the version, just you go to press Windows button, then you will get the command prompt. Okay, once you get the command prompt, then simply you type Mongo. I think I hope you get this MongoD. Just you type it. Then better you click Windows R, run command. In this run command, just you type command. Then I'll close it. I'll close whatever I opened already. Just okay. In order to open the screen, just you click Windows R. That is run. Just you type command. Already I changed the background. Probably you'll get the black screen, and background you'll get the black screen. Yes, don't worry. In this location, if you are not set the environment variable, you have to give the entire path here. What are the location of the like SQL and program files, like that you have to give. It's very complicated each and every time to give this program files everything. So in order to avoid this, already we have set the environment variable. It's not only for MongoDB. It's common to all the programming languages like C, C++, Java. You can use this environment variable setting for all the programming languages. Okay, the first thing is you have to start the MongoDB server. So in order to start the Mongo server, you have to type MongoD. MongoD for server, Mongo for client. Just you type MongoD and press the enter button. Then server gets running. Just you don't close it. Okay, it's not gets entered. So what you can do, don't close it, just simply minimize it. Again, you open one more screen, go to run and click command prompt. Then in order to start the client, you have to type Mongo, not MongoD. All of should be lowercase, all the characters. Just you type Mongo. Then you'll get the screen like this. Once you got it, then you can start the query now. I'll close all the remaining screens. Okay. And the first thing is you have to create the database. In order to create the database, the syntax to create the database is use space database name. Okay, use space database name. Here I'm going to create the name MyDB. Just you type use space MyDB. So what you can do, use space MyDB, then it create the one database in the name of MyDB. You have to work with the client, not a server. Just use MyDB. Just you put simple. Now you are switched into this particular directory. Actually, database means it's similar to the directory or folder. we can say similar to the directory or folder. Once you use this, then it automatically switch to this particular DB. Right now we are in the MyDB database. Then under the database, you can create the number of collections. Okay. In order to confirm the existence of your database, whether the database is actually created or not, in order to know that, simply you can type DB. If you type DB semicolon, then it will show MyDB. Right now you are in the MyDB. Okay. In order to know the existence of DB, whether the MyDB is actually created or not. Right now we are in the MyDB. I hope everyone is able to follow this. In order to view all the DBs, just simply you type show DB. Okay, you can type show DB. It will show all the database. Already we have admin DB, config, local. Right now we are created one more DB, like my DB. We are not having any file in this. By default, we have three DBs, like admin, config, local. Similarly, we have my DB. Okay, this is the procedure to creating the database. If you no need of database, simply you can drop it. This is the syntax to drop the database. The syntax is db dot drop database. If you want, I will show you all the. Okay, if you need, I will paste all the commands through our chat box because I think it's very easy to follow. Just use MyDB, that's enough. Sorry, we have to put semicolon at the end of the statement. You have to put semicolon. Just you copy and execute it. Then DB, it's now to show the existence. Just you copy and paste the command. In order to know all the databases, to get the list of databases, you can type show DB. Just you go, simply copy and paste it. Just you copy and paste in your script. Then your query can get executed. Then db.drop database. In order to drop it, if you want to drop, just you can simply use, I think, but you no need to drop it. One second. That's all. You no need to drop it. Just if this is a procedure to drop it, so you can drop the MyDB. First, you can ensure that the currently saved in MyDB. Okay, before dropping the database, you ensure that currently right now you are in the MyDB. Once you are in the MyDB, then next step you can drop it. Okay, then if you execute this command, then it shows the automatically this drop. But my suggestion is you don't drop it. Then MongoDB query languages. All the query languages are generally you can categorize it to OLTP and OLAP. OLTP for online transaction processing. In RDBMS, mainly we use the, if you want to perform any transaction, the four operations are very, very important. Insert, delete, update, and display. Even the students are doing the project, the four operations are very important. That is the backbone of the every application, like insert, delete, update, and display. Here in MongoDB query also, we are going to do the same operation. The operation is called CRUD operation, C-R-U-D. C for create, R for read, U for update, and D for delete. These are the call it as a core operations in the MongoDB. The create in the sense, it's almost the similar to insert operation. The creation of data using this insert or update or save method. We can create a data using the insert method, or we can modify the existing data. In order to modify that, you can use the update method, or you can use the save method. These are all the methods are used to create the database. Then read method. Once you create it, then you can read the data from it. Here is the find method is used for reading the content from the database. Then update method, again, obviously you can go for update. Update is used for both update as well as the creating. Anyway, for create purpose, we can use the insert method. For read purpose, we can use the find method. For update purpose, we can use the update method. Upset is set to false. Actually, this is a update to the data is accomplished by using the update method. It's upset set to false. Upset means update else insert. If already the data is exist, then it can update it. If there is no data is already exist like that, simply it can insert it. That's it. That's the advantage of upset. Update else insert. That is the thing. Then last one is delete. You can delete the document using that remove method. Okay, for insert purpose, for create purpose, we can use insert. For read purpose, we can use find. For update, again, the update method. Delete purpose, you can use the remove method. That's it. That's the CRUD operation. Next one, you can create a collection. First, you should create a database. In RDBMS, under the database, we can create the table. Here, we can call it a collection instead of table. Because the database, we can change the name. Okay, in RDBMS, we can call it a table. But in MongoDB, we can call it a collection. Under the MyDB only, here, I'm going to create a collection. Collection means it's similar to the table. So if you want to view the existing collection, to create a collection by the name person. Okay, first you can type show collection. It will show all the collections. Okay, it show all the collections. Just I just you copy and paste it. Okay, it will show all the collections. I will show it to you. Even you just you in order to paste it, you no need to type. Just you copy and in mouse, if you have mouse, just you right click it, automatically you are getting this command. Just copy and right click it, then you'll get this command. Just you type. Okay, right now we have two different collections already I have created, so that it can show person and student. Okay, for you, I think you are not having any collection, you are getting the empty. Okay, in order to create a new collection, you can create a collection by the name of person. Okay, you can create a collection by the name of person. The syntax is DB means database. Create collection is a method, that is a existing method, that is predefined method. If you have more than one word, the first word starting letter should be lowercase and the second word starting letter should be in uppercase. I hope there's some programming languages they are using different naming conversion, like camel case and elephant case. So similarly here they followed. If you have used three words, maybe the first word starting letter should be lowercase, and second word and third word onwards, it's the starting letter should be in uppercase for the naming conversion. You can create a collection by the way using this DB means database. Create collection is a predefined method. Here I am going to create the collection by the name of a person. So in order to create the collection by the name of person, just you have to pasted this query. Just you need to type. It takes some time. Just you copy this query, right click and copy it, and you can go to your command prompt and you right click, then automatically you get the same query, db.create collection. Already I have created, so for me it will show the syntax error, but for you it will create successfully. You will get the output. Once you create a collection, then you will get the output like this. Oh, okay, one means you have created that table, like here you can create a collection. Once you create this collection, next thing, now we have created the database. Under the database, we have created the collection. Okay, next, the collection means that the next thing, you have to insert the row or instance or tuple. For that, similarly, you can create one more collection. Similarly, the db.create collection. db.create collection, create a collection by the name food. If you want to drop that collection, newly created collection, you can use db.food.drop. db.collection name is here, food. Drop method, you can drop it. If you want, you can try to create one more collection. I will paste the. If you want, you can try to create one more collection by the name food. This is the procedure to create a one more collection. The next syntax is for dropping the collection. Just here, I'm going to drop the food, not the person. Just you copy and paste it. The collection list after the execution, then you created the one collection and at the same time you have dropped that particular collection. Right now we are having only one collection. The collection list after, if you execute that like show collection, if you type the show collection, then you'll get person. Okay, because right now we are having only one collection by the name collect person. I think no need to type because it takes some time. So better you can copy and paste it. Then if you check the list of collection, maybe similarly you have person and similarly you can create one more collection. I think again you can type show collections and you can create one more collection by the name student. Again the same syntax. Then the collection is successfully created. Once you create a collection, then next thing you have to insert the value. In order to insert the value, the syntax is DB, that means database. Here I created the student name, collection name by the collection name is here student. So you have to mention the collection name dot method. Method name is insert. In this insert method, you have to mention the ID, let us assume that we each and every row have different column. The first column is ID, second column name is student name, third column is grade, fourth column is hobbies. That's what I said, it's a key value pair. The key is ID, student name, grade and hobbies. The values are 1, Raj, 4 and cricket. The ID value is 1, student name is Raj and grade is 4 and hobbies is cricket. Okay, this is the combination of key value pair. You have to give this value within the insert method, that is open bracket and close bracket. You have to mention this. Let us assume that in our database we have 4 different columns like ID, student name, grade and hobby. Just you no need to type it, just simply you copy and paste it. Yeah, okay, in order to this, do this, just you simply copy, just right click and copy, and you go to client edition, not a server edition. Just you right click your mouse, then you will get, okay, then you will get the query like this. Collection. Already have the, just before the thing, you have to ensure you right now you are in this student collection. Okay, just you copy and paste it, then you will get this. Automatically your values are get inserted. Then if you want to check it, you can check it. Check the document for student Raj has been successfully created or not. In order to know that, the next thing you have to, again, you have to type show collection. It will show it whether it's successfully created or not. Then you will get the output like this. That's all the insert method. This is the insert method. You can insert the data in the collection. Then you can check if the documents of our student Raj has been successfully inserted or not. In order to check it, you can use the find method. Again, DB database, that's what our collection name is student, and the find method, you can check it, whether the document is successfully inserted or not. Just simply you can type it, students, then you can type the find in two different ways. Simply you can put find, or you can type find.pt. The difference between find and find.pt, the find.pt, it can print the output in the format, okay, in specified format. Okay, in the, actually the difference between find and find.pt, pretty, it can print the output in the aligned format. Okay, pretty can print the output in the aligned format. If you want the output in the aligned format, better you can go always, you can go for pretty method. My suggestion is always you can go for find.pt, because here we can get, it can print the output in the aligned format. Then if you want to insert one more value, again you can use the insert method. My suggestion, you no need to type this all. Again, you can go to insert method. Just I pasted all the queries here. Just simply you copy and paste it. Okay, just you simply you copy and paste it, paste your client edition. Then you will get the, already I have installed, for me it will show the error. Okay, it shows the error for you, it will execute it successfully. Then if you want, we see the output in specified format, in the aligned format, again you can use the pretty method, find.pretty method. Right now I have inserted two different rows or records. Okay, again, yeah, first I inserted the first row, and then second I inserted the second row. Similarly, the third row. So that's all, the insert is over and the find is also over. Next, the update. Update means insert the document Arvind, actually the student name is Arvind here, Arvind into the student collection, only if it does not already exist in the collection. That's why I said upset true. Upset true means, actually here I'm going to insert the ID value is 3, student name is Arvind and grade is 6. Here I am going to set the hobbies as scatting. Okay, here I am going to set hobbies as scatting. It upset, it is true. Upset is true means update else insert. If you are having the value in Arvind, okay, in the name, by the name of Arvind or ID is 3, then it's going to update the existing value. If it's not getting the value, like if there is no existing value, simply it can insert it. Update else insert. The values exist, then it can perform update operation. Otherwise, it simply performs the insert operation. Simply, it's going to insert the value like ID, student name, grade, hobby, etc. sometimes we are not sure that whether this Ali is available or not, so that we can go for like this. Then upset is true. If you want, you can. You can just to copy paste it. Now, right now we have inserted the three different value. If you want to view the third student value detail, simply you can mention that ID value. That is that I said the primary key value. It's a unique value for each and every instance. If you want to see the particular person detail, simply you can type db.student.find. In find method, within find, you have to mention the primary key value. That is the unique value. That's what here always you can prefix. It can add the underscore value. For one of my suggestions, you no need to type because it takes some time. Because even MongoDB, we can explain this concept even though one day, more than one day also is required. So here I'm going to focus only the important concept. You no need to type it, just you simply copy and paste it. Whenever you have the time, you can practice it. Also, later I'll tell the materials and books, you can easily able to follow this. The one more important thing, the MongoDB, nowadays many people are using this MongoDB, even for students also many, because it's very comfortable. Comparing with RDBMS, it's easy to learn. And also, comfortably we can handle the data. You can store and retrieve the data without any headache. Similarly, you can set the hobbies as chess and upset through. Like that, if you want, you can execute it. You can update the value. Okay, you can update. Again, I use the upset. Upset means update else insert. Again, if you confirm the required changes, if you perform any changes, then actually I said that initially the hobbies were, hobbies is scatting. Here, hobbies is scatting. The next step, I'm going to change the hobbies as chess instead of scatting. In order to change it, again, you need to use the update method. Here also, you have to use update method. The remaining things are same. ID, student name, Arvind, everything is same. But here I'm going to set the hobbies as chess instead of scatting. Then if you, again, in order to ensure that whether your whatever you change it, that will be modified or not, in order to know that, again, you can use the find method. If you want to type it, then you'll get the output. You'll get the output. Maybe if you want to view the output, you can use find method or find that pretty. My suggestion is always you can go for find method. Sometimes you are not getting the aligned format. Anyway, that's not a big issue. Anyway, you'll get the output. In MongoDB query language, again, this is the update method. The EN you can update based on some constraint like age is greater than 18 and less than 18. Then you can set some value under multi true. Sometimes we can change the values for multiple columns also. We can simultaneously perform the update operation. Okay. If for update operation, whatever the operation be for performing any operation, just always you can use this find method. Whether before performing any changes, you can see what are the values are available in this particular thing. Okay. Once you see, then you can perform any modification. Then if you want to add a new column in this particular collection, already we have four different columns. I'm going to add one more column by the name location. And also here I given the column name as well as the corresponding value is Chennai. So that also possible. You can add the one more column like location and values are Chennai. For the particular row, that is third row. That's what I mentioned, ID 3. For that you can do it. Once you perform changes, then you have the next step. You have to ensure whether that successfully inserted column or not. In order to know that, just you can use the find method. That's find that pretty. Again, it update and set location as Chennai. I think that is fast anyway. And the thing is, you no need to type the query because I copy and paste every query, so you no need to type it. Then similarly, the remove method. The remove method, simply here we have to use the remove method. Based on some constraint, yeah, suppose whatever the operation, simply use the find method and pd. In order to remove it, you can use the remove method or you can use the unset. Unset means if you are going to work with some value, you want to remove some value, you can use the dollar symbol. Okay, db dot collection name dot update method. Within update method, you have to mention all the parameters. You are going to perform update on third row. That's what the primary key value, ID 3. Then unset location. Just now we have inserted the new column as location. Now I'm going to unset. Unset means it's going to remove the location by Chennai. Simply you can use it. If you execute this query, then it automatically it can remove the particular column location from the our existing collection. It can remove it. If you want to check it, then next you can ensure that with the help of this find and pretty, whether the column is successfully removed or not. Then it will get removed. Then similarly the find method also. If you want to say, check the particular student before proceeding, okay, student name Arvind, you can use this. Is there any document is having the student name as Arvind? You can use it. Okay, simply you can type like find method. Again, the syntax is not much complicated. In the first time only it looks somewhat different. Once you, the same syntax you are going to follow. My suggestion is always you can go for the pretty method, because you will get the output in the proper aligned format. Okay, then the next thing, the find method. Here you can display the student name from all the documents of the student collection. If you, the identifier ID should be suppressed and not displayed. I want to display all the details without ID number. That is that I don't want a unique value like ID. In order to suppress that value, you can mention the put the empty within the empty bracket. You no need to mention it here. You no need to mention the underscore ID. And also at the end, you have to mention the underscore ID is zero. It means it's going to suppress the value. It can show all the values except that ID. Okay, it's going to show all the values except that ID. Just you can, if you don't want to have any unique value, you can remove it. Similarly, here it can display the student name and the grade from all the documents in the student collection, but it suppress the ID. It can print the student name and the grade without ID value. If you want, you can use it. Otherwise, you can suppress the ID value. And then some relational operators also you can use it, like equal, not equal, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, greater than or less than. Just for simply, suppose if you want to find the documents with the grade is 8 to 7, maybe you can use db dot student is collection name find. Within the find method, you can mention the constraint like grade is equal to 7. Simply you can type, then you'll get the output. Similarly, due to some time constraint, I will explain this. If you have time, you can actually already share this PPT to sir, and maybe the sir will share this PPT. Maybe it's a copyright issue. You can use this PPT for your personal use. You can don't share it. You can use it for your personal use. And also my suggestion, if you have time, you can use some web material and you can practice it. If you have any doubt, you can always, you are welcome to mail me. I will help you. Whatever you have the doubt, if you find any struggle to for the installation or the executing the query, you can send the mail to mail me. I'll help you. Whatever I know, just I will help you. Similarly, the not equal to operation, it's not equal to, the grade is not equal. And in means, suppose the chess are scatting, the hobby is either chess or scatting, it can print the output. And not in. In the sense, neither chess or not scatting, like that. And similarly, the cricket and the student name is in the same way. You have used multiple operators. And the student name whose name is begins with K, means you can use this syntax. And whose student name ends in J, like that you can use it. Similarly, the student name has an R. In the student name, is there any character is an R? Like that you can use it. Slash R, slash R, slash dot, slash, like that. Like a regular expression R. The remaining comments all are same. It looks like big, but it's not. It's very, very, very simple. And then regular expression is there. Similarly, you can use a count, a limit, sort, and skip. Count means it can find the number of documents in the student collection. For that, you can use the count method. Similarly, the grade is 7. The count, the number of documents in the student collection where grade is 7. Some constraint. Similarly, limit means you can retrieve the first 3 documents from the student collection. Even though you inserted the 10th instance, but it can show only the first 3. If you want 5 documents, similarly, you can use it, limit of 5. Like that. Then, to sort the value. In order to sort the values, you can use sort. You can sort the instance or rows based on student name. Maybe it can arrange the instance rows in the ascending order. If you want descending order, simply you can put the student name as -1. -1 means it will print in the descending order. Then similarly, the document from student collection, grade in ascending order and the hobby also in ascending order. If you want change, you can change it. Grade is ascending order. If you want descending order, then hobby you can mention as -1. Simply, if you want to skip the first 2 documents, you can use the skip method. Skip of 2, then it can skip the first 2 documents from the student collection. Simply, it's skip the first 2 document. And similarly, it can -2 means it can skip the last 2 documents. And skip of 2 means it can print the first 2 documents. Then limit of 3 means it can print the third row, fourth row, fifth row. It will skip the first 2 documents, then print the third row, fourth row, and fifth row. That's it. The reference is better. You can follow this book. There's a Big Data and Analytics by Seema Acharya and Subhash Nichalappan, widely publication. And you can use some web reference also. Okay, thank you to all. If you have any doubt, if you need, I am ready to execute this all, but due to the time constraint, I close this. Anyway, I share this PPT to sir. You can practice it if you have, find any doubt. One second. I think you have, sorry, I think we have time now. I thought the time is 4 o'clock. Okay, no problem. We have a half an hour more. We will execute the query one by one. I thought now time is, okay, you have now time is 3:30 only. We have half an hour more. Again, we will execute the query one by one. Sorry for that. Okay, by mistake, my watch is shown the wrong time. Okay, anyway, we will execute the query one by one. I hope, sorry for that. I think we have, do you have any doubt in this up to this? I think, is it comfortable to you? We have successfully installed and we have changed the configuration. And we have changed the configuration, everything. And I hope now you are very comfortable to create the database like my use MyDB. And you can create under the database, you can create the collection. You can create the number of collections under the database. Then once you create the collection and this index to drop the collection, once you create the collection, then we can insert the rows or instance or tuples. Okay, you can insert it one by one based on this is what primary key value, this is the column value. Simply, I said difference between find and find that pretty. Find means simply it can print the output. That find that pretty, it can print the output in the aligned format. Similarly, you can insert the one more. In order to insert it, the syntax to insert the value DB, database name dot collection name dot then insert of that is that's it. Okay, this is the syntax. Even you no need, I will write the thing.
Dr. Vinod, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, one question from Kavita Anand. Actually, he asking question, what is advantage of MongoDB over Excel?
Over Excel?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, even if your data is very small, better we can, normally the Excel, even though you are having the Excel, it's very difficult to gain some insight. Simply where we can store the data and we can perform some process. In order to gain the insight, we have to perform different process, like we have to draw the graphs and many things. But if you use the database, maybe here we can store the very large volume of data. I think the Excel, we have some constraint. I think the maximum number of columns, I think there is no constraint in the row. But anyway, we have some constraint for storing the data. And also it takes some time for the access. If you use the DB, database, maybe we can execute the program in effectively and efficiently. Maybe the retrieval time is very less in database. We store the data in the database. Maybe it takes very less time for the retrieval. But in MySQL, if you are going to deal with very small amount of data, maybe that's no problem. Let assume that if you have 20,000 instance, I think I executed recently. I executed one program. I think I totally 15,000 instance are there. Maybe. And maybe 20 or 30 columns are there. In order to execute that program, it takes around 1.5 days. That is one of the main topics. So better, instead of storing this SQL, maybe we can move the data from MySQL into the Excel sheet into the any DB. Maybe the execution time is very less in database. And also one more thing, here we can store the large volume of data. I think in the Excel where we can store only the structured data, but I think it's very difficult to maintain the unstructured data, semi-structured data. Anyway, the MongoDB, here we can store the unstructured data. And also, here I already said the difference between Oracle and MongoDB. Even if you use the Oracle, that even though there is a proprietary version, where you can store only up to the 1 terabyte of data. But it's not possible to store the data more than 1 terabyte. But in MongoDB, where we can store the data, even the more than 1 terabyte also. This is one of the main advantage. Already shown the many vendors and many industries that are following the MongoDB. But recently our peer students also, many students are using this MongoDB for the project work because it's very comfortably you can use it. And also it's a landing, it's a understanding is very easy. Here there is no join concept. If you use the RDBMS, the join means we have to retrieve the data from multiple tables. When you are retrieving the data, if you are going to retrieve the value from only one table, then there is no problem. You can easily, you can get it. If you, when you are going to retrieve the data from multiple tables, even though it's a two table, three table also very simple. Sometimes you have to retrieve the values from the you have to compare the many tables. Maybe the time complexity. Time complexity means how long time it takes for the execution. If you are going to, if you retrieve the data from only one table, then there is no problem. Simply you can retrieve it. If you are retrieve the value from more than one table, maybe let us assume that you are going to retrieve the value from 10 different tables, but before retrieving the data, you have to perform some comparison. Maybe the comparison will take some time. Maybe the execution, maybe it's a very long time it will take. So even the time complexity is mainly depends on the number of comparison. So the, if you are not getting the quick response, but anyway, the MongoDB quickly you can get the response. But the thing is, you should write the query like this. That's one of the main advantage. The two main purpose: the quick response and large volume, where we can deal with the large volume of data. And that step here, we can even here we can deal with the unstructured data. That is the advantage. Any other doubt?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Actually, I have small doubts, sir. Actually, yes, normally we are doing stock verification in library. We are using the Excel format.
Yes,
so far, yes, actually, you are talking about the MongoDB as a very highlighted, and because of our observing your lesson, whether it is a possible to apply to the library for stock verification alone.
You can, we can apply it, sir. But the thing is, if a data is a structured data, if a data is also not a small volume of data, better you can go for it. So even the RDBMS is enough, MySQL or Oracle is enough. Where the thing is, when you are going to deal with the large volume of data. If suppose I want to predict the temperature of tomorrow's temperature, for that I can use the last 1 month data. I think that I use the last 1 year data. So that situation, we are having very large volume of data. Maybe your data set size is too large and you are not going to deal with the unstructured data, means we can go for MongoDB. Otherwise, if your data set size is too less and even if your data is a structured data, better you can go for RDBMS is much better. Actually, this MongoDB is not a replacement of RDBMS. Depends on our requirement, we can choose it. Any other doubt?
Thank you. Okay. Any questions, doubts from participants, please?
You can ask other
questions. Yes, sir. I'm Kavita. Thanks for the question. But only I have one more question. That,
yes,
ma'am. Until you were giving the example of, I think, structured data and not unstructured data, like how
unstructured data means nothing. Unstructured data means I will show an example. Even here I mean that unstructured means, if you have, let us assume that the table, in this table you have serial number, roll number, then name, age, gender, age, a place. Maybe the first row I am going to use all the value, roll number 101, name Raj, then age 31, place Chennai. Then second value also I am going to use this all the value, me, that is structured data. But here I am going to store only the roll number and the name, not age and the place. The third one I am going to store 103, name and the age, but I'm not going to store place. Even this is also considered as an unstructured data. But the thing is, if you use the RDBMS like Oracle or MySQL, unnecessarily, even though you are not utilizing this space, but by default it will occupy some memory space, but it allocates some memory space for even those unstructured data. This is one of the main drawback of the RDBMS and like the MySQL and Oracle. But if you use the MongoDB, it will not allocate any memory space for this unutilized space. It can allocate the memory space for only the utilized space. That is the difference between RDBMS and MongoDB. Whatever the value you are using, it will allocate the memory, it reserves the memory for only the whatever the values you are using. But in Oracle, sometimes let us think that if you have one or two records, then there is no problem. Sometimes we are in the position to handle with the 10,000 or 20,000 tuples. Sometimes the more, if you are using any unstructured data, maybe many empty values. Sometimes the empty values is larger than the actual value. The empty values is larger than the actual value. So that's what sparse data. One of the main drawbacks is the MySQL and Oracle. So these kind of problems are rectified with the help of this storing the unstructured data. That's what I said. Any other doubt? Even we can deal with like unstructured data, like the text data, even audio data, video data, also you can deal with it. If you have time, we can discuss it. But anyway, I given only the basic. Due to the time constraint, maybe this I have given only the limited. But if you know the syntax, then you can practice it. If you know the environment, if you know how to work with it, then you can practice it. Okay. Then any other doubt?
Yeah, thank you, sir. Only thing, like it not need to specify that I have given the database. Like database will itself take that I have not given value to the rest of the column or rest of the variables. Is that so?
Yeah. Ma'am, the thing is, in database, it can...
Roll number name I have given, but next three variables I have not given. So database itself will take, or I need to tell the database that I am not going to give this for that record. That's fine.
But the thing is, if you use RDBM, Oracle or MySQL, it unnecessarily, it will occupy the space for even the empty place, even though you have not entered the data. But it's a structure, because whenever you write the RDBMS query, you mention like this. Suppose roll number means you will mention number of 4. Maybe if the 4 digit is reserved for this roll number, whether it were used or not, it doesn't matter. But it will occupy 4 bytes for each and every roll number, for each and every record. But this is the one of the drawback. But in MongoDB, we are not mentioning any constraint like this. Simply we can use the number, we no need to mention any constraint like this. Then based on the requirement, it will allocate. If you enter any value, it can allocate the memory. Otherwise, it will not allocate the memory. Here, we are not restricted like RDBMS, but RDBMS or MySQL. In RDBMS, you use a number. In MySQL, we can use the integer. Here, you have to mention integer as 4, means even though you are using or not using the roll number, but by default, it will allocate the 4 byte. But here, the MongoDB is not like that. Once you enter the value, then it will allocate the memory based on the enter, okay, whatever you have entered in that database. That is the thing.
Yeah, good point. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Then any other point? There are small changes. That's it. Then any other? Okay, let me start the execution now because I skipped many slides. I hope now you are comfortable to insert these values like find. Then the 4 operations are very, very important. I said the CRUD operation. Create, read, update, and delete. I think these all the operations are very convenient for you. I think we have executed all the commands up to this. Am I right? Okay. This one second. Okay. Student find that grade is equal to 7. Okay. Then to use some relational operators, equal to, not equal to, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, greater than or less than. Here we can find the documents where the grade is 8 to 7. You have inserted a number of instances, that is row, but the thing is here you have to search the whose grade is equal to 7. In order to know that, you can type DB means database, student means collection name, then find is a method. In order to access the find method, you should mention the collection. So we are going to apply the find method on the student collection. So you have to type db.students.find method. The find is a method. Method means it has some open bracket and close bracket. So normally the method means it's a find method, open bracket, close bracket. Within this open bracket, close bracket, you can give some argument, find of argument. Okay, you can give the argument. The method means the general definition of the method is it's set up to perform some task and finally it returns some value. Okay, it's set up to perform some task and finally it returns some value. It actually returns the method call, that is function. Simply you can call it a method or function. Both are same. Function or method. In C and C++ programming language, simply we can call it a function. In Java, we can call it a method. But anyway, both are the same. In some programming language, it may get differ. Actually, here you have the function call and the function definition. I'll show the one, give an example. Suppose the add of 10, 20 is a function call. Then we can write the corresponding function definition. Add of like that. It's a simple C program example. Here we can perform some operation and finally it's going to return some value. This is a function call or method call. It will call the corresponding function definition. The 10 is assigned to here, the 20 is assigned to y. Then if I put a z equal to x plus y and a return of z, what will happen? If return of z means that simply it is going to add the 10 plus 20 as 30, the 30 is stored in this variable z, then it is going to print the 30. Maybe the function call or method call is replaced by that returned value, that is 30. That value is stored into x, and not x, say a. Similarly, this was a relationship between function call and the function definition. Here we are going to use the function call, not a function definition. In the find method, we are going to use the function call. But the thing is, we no need to define the function because everything is already defined. Yes, simply we are passing the grade is equal to 7 as an argument. Then what is this function will call the corresponding function definition, or method will call the corresponding method definition. Then that will perform some task. Then finally that will return the output to this. Then anyway, this function call is replaced with this output. That's what, if whenever you are executing this command, then we will use any function, then we'll get the output. Then next one, suppose the find those documents that grade is not to 7. Means you have to use here NE. Instead of equal means you have to use EQ. Not equal means you have to use NE. That is N for not, E means equal. That is not equal to. Just you can practice this query. This is for not equal. Similarly, you can suppose you can find the documents from the student collection where the hobbies is either chess or skating. If even any value, the hobbies may be chess or skating, it will print all the rows whose hobbies is either chess or skating. You can practice it. Then similarly, the hobbies set to neither to chess or nor is skating. Both are not there. So you can use the only one things are different. If it is either means you have to use in anyone. If not in means you have to use NIN. That is not in. Then next one, simply you can find the find method. To find the those documents from the student collection where the hobby is set to cricket and the student name is set to Raj. Based on some constraint, I am going to print it. Where the hobby is cricket and the student name is Raj. Even if you want only one condition, you can mention only the hobbies as cricket. This is also possible. Then here, this is what I said. To find those documents from the student collection where student name is begins with K. So db dot collection name dot find method. Here we already know the column name. Okay, student name. The starting letter should be K. So you have to use the upper cap, then K. They're dot pretty. Pretty means you know that you will get the output in the align format. Within find is a method or a function. You have to pass whatever you need. You can pass as an argument. Then to next one, to find those documents with the student collection where the student name is ends in G. These are very complicated in Excel. Okay, if you want, maybe you can do it, but it takes some time. But he said we can comfortably, you can store the data, process the data, and retrieve the data comparing with Excel. Then yeah, whose name is ends with J. Simply you can use the db.student.find. For my advice, you no need to type it, just simply you copy and paste it. Okay, copy, and you can go to this, not a server edition, because you are not getting the thing here. You can go to the client edition and you click, right click on your mouse, then you'll get it. Then you'll get the output like this. ID is equal to 1, student name Raj, grade is equal to 4, and hobby says cricket. Because whose name is ends with J? Yes, the name is ends with J is Raj. Similarly, you can execute this all the commands here to find those documents from the student collection where student name has an R. You can use this symbol syntax, or you can use the second syntax, or you can use the third syntax. The dollar regular expression means, the dollar means always we can get the value. Regular expression means R. You can use any one of these syntax. But the remaining things are all are same. The difference is only this thing, whose name, student name has an R. You can use any one of these syntax, then you'll get the output. I will execute it. Just you copy and paste it. Go to client edition, not the server edition. Just you paste and press enter. See here, student name is Kumar, and like that, the okay, any place we have R, Kumar, the name Kumar, we have the character as R, and Arvind also have the character as R. This way we can get the value. That's the relational operators, and similarly the regular expression. To find the document from the student collection where the student name ends in R. I think I'm a little bit fast, but the thing is, you no need to type the each and every query. Just whenever you have time, my advice is you can practice the query. Just you can type the word one by one whenever you have free time. Next, some operations like count to find the number of documents in the student collection. For that, you can type db dot collection name dot method name is here called count. So you can type this. Just you simply you copy and paste your command prompt in the MongoDB client. Just if you want to clear screen, just you can use a CLS. CLS means that will clear it. Clear the screen. CLS. CLS for clear the screen. Just you right click, then you will get the paste. Right now we have entered only the three color, three rows or three tuples. So we got the value of 3. Next, to find the number of documents in the student collection where the grade is 7. Number of documents in the student collection where the grade is 7. Simply you can type it. You can copy and paste it. Right click and number of documents in the 0 document. I think there is no rows with the value 7. If you want, you can print it, you can type accordingly. Then, because previously I used many rows. Similarly, the if you want to print the, once again, I will check grade. I think that we have entered many grade value previously. There is one. Okay, grade is 6. We have entered the grade 6. Okay, we will check 6 instead of the 4. Not 7. We will check the 6 grade value as 6 instead of 4. Okay, will you see here? We have only one document. We have only one document. We have installed. Similarly, count number of documents is it. Then I'm going to the students are also asked to enter your attendance and feedback link. Don't forget to fill the attendance and feedback link. Okay. Here you can say instead of 7, you can put the 6 also, because in this example I have used the 6. Sorry, faculty, sorry, professor. Hi. Sorry. Okay. Copy, then here you can use the grade is 6 db dot student find grade is 6 and limit 3 means it can print only the first 3 rows, but anyway we have only one student grade is 6, so it can print. Let us think that you have 10 different value, even though it has the 10 different rows has the value as grade is 6, but it will print only the first 3 grades, the first 3 student details. That's it. That is in this way we can restrict it. This way we can restrict. Then sorting, the count and limit is over. Next, to sort the number of document, that is student document from the student collection in the ascending order. For the db dot to collection name dot find dot sort of student name 1. Student name 1 means it can sort the tuples or rows in the ascending order. If it is a minus 1 means it can sort in the descending order. 1 means it can print in the student name in the ascending order, the alphabetic order. If minus 1 means it can print in the descending order. For that clear in the screen, you can use CLS. See here, it can print in the ascending order. But instead of doing the my plus 1, I am going to put minus 1. It can print it in the descending order. The first time Arvind Kumar Raj, but in descending order Raj Kumar and Arvind. That's the difference between ascending and descending. Then to sort the document from the student collection, first thing, there are two constraints here. First thing is the grade is 1 and habit is 1. Both are in the habit. If you want the habit in descending order, grade in ascending order and the habit in descending order means you have to put habit as minus 1. Both are ascending order means you have to put 1. One is both are descending order means you have to put minus 1. One is ascending order and another is descending order means in ascending order you have to put 1 and for descending order you have to put minus 1. simply you can my screen is visible to you?
No sir, you are doing something, it is visible.
No sir, I'm not doing, someone is doing this sir.
Yeah, because sir,
I'm not doing it. Someone is opening the Dinatandi, that's what I'm asking. Is it possible to close it?
Yeah, please sir.
Okay. Actually, I'm not using that.
That's what that is what doing.
Oh, okay. No problem. Someone is checking the mail. I thought someone is.
Yeah.
Okay. But
actually, then somebody next one doing mistake.
Yes, sir.
Unknowingly doing.
Yeah. Okay. No problem. Then next one is to start the document from the student collection. First on grade and second constraint is on hobby. Both are in ascending order. Both are in ascending order. You have to put one. If descending order means minus one and one is ascending, descending, accordingly you have to change it. Then that's it. Skip means you can skip the, if you want to skip only the first two documents from the student collection, you can use the skip method. Normally the method it can perform some action. So db dot student collection name dot find and skip of two dot pretty. Simply pretty means you know that just print the output in the aligned format. Just if you want to, you no need to type it. Then just you right click and it will show the output. Here I have practiced only the three rows. If for you, you can insert more rows like 10 or 20 rows for the better understanding. The next to sort the document from the student collection and skip the first document from the output. Okay, you have to sort the student document in the ascending order and skip the first document from the output. For that you can type the query like this. Db dot student dot find skip the first document, that was skip of one. Then remaining rows are arranged in the ascending order. That's it. Remaining rows are arranged in the ascending order. See here, you got the here already have the three rows, but the first row is the student name is Arvind. It can skip the first row where the student name is Arvind, but it will print the remaining row. Even the remaining rows also we can limit it based on, okay. If you want to display the last two records, we can use the db dot student dot count of minus two. It can print only the last two records. If you want to first two records, you can use skip of two. You can use it limit of two. If you want the last two records, you can perform the count and you have to subtract the minus two, so that it can display the last two records from the student collection. People is not visible. Whether I think someone says PPT is not visible. One second.
Are you showing PPT, sir?
Yes,
now?
Sir. I'm showing. Yes, sir. From the beginning onwards, I started showing the PPT.
Yeah, now it's okay, sir. Now it's okay.
Okay. Someone is presented, I think.
Yes. Actually, the end of the session, no time. That's what everybody is getting lazy.
And see here to display the last two records from the student collection. For that, you have to use their students account of minus two. Similarly, to retrieve their, suppose if you want to retrieve the third, fourth, and fifth document from the student collection, for that, you have to use DB means database, student collection, find method, PT means that print output in the aligned format. You have to skip the first two rows. In order to skip the first two rows, you have to put skip of two. Limit of three means simply if we are using the limit of three without skip means it prints first three rows. But the thing is here, first you have to skip the two rows, then you have to print the three rows. It means that it can skip the first two rows, then it can print the next three rows, like third row, fourth row, fifth row. For that, you have to type the command like this. For the practice, you can easily get it. I think that's all the thing is over. Anyway, similarly, you have many queries once you know the syntax of this one, know the procedure to execute it, then you can do it. You can use any online resource or the textbook reference. Then you can practice it. If you have any doubt, you can mail me. I'll give my mail ID and contact number. You know that mapcoeng.ac.in. My contact number is 8610948355. Okay, thank you to all. If you have any doubt, you can ask me through our chat box, or even you can ask me. Otherwise, you can send the mail. Okay, thank you to all. Sir, that's all the session is over, sir. Hello.
Thank you, sir, for giving excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Really, it is enjoyable one right from beginning. So,
thanks.
excellent. We're coming and you're accepting our request. And thank you for all the audience from different state. One second, we are meet tomorrow. So exactly before this, 10 minutes before the session, all the requests, please come and join. Thank you, sir. Thank you.